Good evening. Welcome to UPARS Los Angeles. It's August 2018. My name is Steve Murillo. I'm the director for UPARS LA. We have an excellent presentation tonight, along the veins of abduction. And you guys are, many of you here are very, very interested in that subject of ufology, that piece of ufology. Steve Neill is a special effects makeup artist, a filmmaker, a puppeteer, a model maker, and a visual effects artist in film and television in a career that spans over the last 35 years. He started in the industry at American Zoetrope just after high school, where he produced his first film, Arthur, not the one that you guys saw. He was mentored, listen to this, he was mentored by Francis Ford Coppola and became very good friends with him. So he, at a high school, volunteered to be a you know, just to work for free, and he ended up working for Francis Ford Coppola. Moving to Hollywood, Steve met Joe Blasco, where he apprenticed for a short while before becoming friends with Rick Baker, who gave him his start in Hollywood. Later, he met Bob Schieffer, who was head of Disney makeup, and then became friends with Fred B. Phillips as a result of being friends with Bob Schieffer. Steve Neill first worked Fred B. Phillips on Star Trek, The Motion Picture. How many saw that one? One of my favorites. His first assignment was to make Spock's ears. That was his first assignment. That's a simple one. Additionally, he designed and made the appliances for the domed-headed alien on the bridge that was applied by Steve. After working on Star Trek, Steve went to work for John Chambers, working prosthetics and puppet heads for National Lampoon's Class Reunion. He also worked on Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country, another great movie, as a sculptor and prosthetic maker of numerous Klingon forehead pieces. Additionally, he worked on Star Trek The Next Generation, pilot episode Encounter at Farpoint, a classic. A classic. Steve Neill was also one of the famous Hollywood gorilla men. Over the course of many years, he made three gorilla suits and performed in many commercials, TV shows, and movies. Additionally, he created the McDonald's Matt Tonight Moon character, who I never really liked, but anyway. It was kind of creepy. But it was very popular for many years on McDonald's commercials. And coincidentally, so Steve got that guy his first job being the body inside that head. And how many people saw Shape of Water? Yeah, Oscar-winning movie. That same guy was the monster in that movie. He was the creature. So Steve gave him his break, and look where he ended up. It's pretty neat. Steve worked on Crater Lake Monster, 1977. I missed that one. Laser Blast, I'd like to see that one. Steve created, wrote, and produced The Day Time Ended. He worked on Ghostbusters, Friday Night, and many other sci-fi horror films. Steve is currently in production at SNG Studios, and he's working on his labor of love, and it's called But Something Is There, and you guys are going to see, actually, I don't think the public has seen this, so you're going to be the first ones to see the first episode. SNG Studios is also an apprenticeship program where Steve is mentoring the next generation of movie-making artists. So he's returning the favor to the young people of this world. That's great. Steve Neill continues to work in the industry and owns SNG Studios in Ventura, California. He's driven all the way down here to meet with you guys today and present his work. So please give a warm welcome to Steve Neill. This is your life, right?
Yeah, it is. I want to thank everybody for coming to see this film. It started quite a long time ago, in fact, back in the early 50s, when I first started having encounters with things I couldn't explain. And that remains to this day. I can't explain it. I don't know what I'm dealing with. I'm not really frightened by it. I'm fascinated by it. I think it has a lot to do with the evolution of consciousness. That's just my pet theory. It seems to beckon that. But ultimately, I don't have a lot of information about my experience more than reporting exactly what happened to me and what I have experienced or what I continue to experience. So this film's a little different than probably films you've seen in the past, like Fire in the Sky and things like that. This is really directly from my experience and very honest about it without putting any theories into it or conjecture about who the visitors are, where they come from, why they're doing these things, other than the fact that I feel very strongly this has to do with consciousness by reconnecting us as spirit to spirit of this universe, to nature, and all the things that we're doing a really good job of separating ourselves from currently, which is putting this planet into a downhill spiral. And it doesn't have to keep going like this. It's definitely not going to. We are going to succeed. I firmly believe that. But I feel that that's what this is really about. So Yvonne Smith is here also, somewhere. There's Yvonne. You want to come up and say a few words? Yvonne, I've worked with Yvonne for years now, since as early, I think we first met, what, 1990 or 91? Through Don and Vicky at UFO Magazine. And I later then went to Yvonne to talk to her about the fact that I felt I was having these experiences. That was based mostly on another friend of mine, Whitley Strieber's book, Communion. And like so many of us, there was no internet back in those days. There weren't a lot of books on the subject. And that book came out, and there was that being on that cover. And then you read the book, and everything you knew was in there, yet you didn't know this man. You'd never talked to him before or met him. And it was like an onion after that, that just kept peeling open more and more. Because that was 1987, and by the time I met Yvonne, we started working together. I started doing drawings for her, not just on the things I experienced, but also other people within CIRO and their experiences that she still uses to this day in her lectures, so, and books. So, and Yvonne's going to come up here with me, and we're going to answer some questions and stuff after we run the film. But I think we should run the film and let the film do most of the talking. So, what do you think? Should we run the film? Okay. This is the pilot episode. It took us 2 years to produce it because Mary and I... Oh, there you are. We felt very strongly if we tried to get this financed, we tried to go with private funding, they would do what they always do to this subject matter. And what do they always do to it?
Change it.
Yeah. I mean, Fire in the Sky is a perfect example, isn't it? You all read Travis's book. So we didn't want that to happen. So we worked with industry people that I've known for years, I've worked with. They volunteer their time on weekends. And we pulled this together, and weekend by weekend we shot this, we built sets, we went all out to make this, and that took 2 years. If we were to do this again, it'll take a few months, you know, because then we'll be financed and a regular line, but that's what it did, that's what it took us, so. Anyway, we'll run the film. Thank you.
I'm not on Earth. I'm not on Earth. I'm not on Earth.
No. You're not.
Have you ever considered where you are and what you're part of? As you wake each day and pass through your daily life routines, as normal or typical as they may seem to you, you are part of a much greater reality. Our Earth is in free fall, orbiting our star in the vacuum of space. And this star is one of billions that make up our Milky Way galaxy. But it doesn't stop there. There are billions of galaxies also that make up our universe. And today, science has detected that there are more universes and other dimensions. Quantum physics is showing us that traversing large distances from star to star is possible. We are close to achieving interstellar travel. And even time travel has left the realm of myth. It too has been shown by science to be possible. And one day soon, we will travel through time at will. And other dimensions? They're there too. We're on the verge of great discovery. It's just beginning. Knowing this, before we begin exploring the unknown with these stories, we need to remember that nothing in our experience can be too far removed or impossible in this incredible and amazing journey we all share called life. Mark is a man with lifelong experiences with the unknown. In this series, he will share with us an honest accounting of what has happened to him. In doing so, he represents thousands, if not millions, of people across the world that have had or may have the same experience. Tonight, we will start where it all began for Mark, his first memories of the visitors entering his life.
I remember very well the first time this all started. I was only 7 years old, sleeping in my cozy bed in our San Francisco flat. My bedroom was part of an old San Francisco house turned into two flats years ago. We lived in the lower level flat. It was a cozy old building that was once a Victorian house, now modernized. As I sleep soundly, I had no idea what was about to happen to me. The most important experience of my life, and that it has been. Something totally unknown and strange was about to make itself known to me and forever change how I view reality. My life at this point had been average for a boy growing up in the 50s. My parents both worked and I went to school. I was an only child with no brothers or sisters. I had a large bedroom to myself that looked towards playland and the ocean. My interests were different than most kids my age. I had my eyes on the stars. I loved astronomy, art, science, and music. I still joke today that my first football was a telescope. I always wondered when I looked up at the night sky what was out there. This night, I would find out. Next thing I knew, it was morning. I felt panicked, remembering what had happened, but beyond the point of that creature's face, I couldn't remember anything else. Not even how I got on the rug. Could remember that I was so scared that night that sometimes I would sneak in to sleep on the bed with my parents. I was afraid of the lightning people. At least that's what I remember my mother telling me. That's what I called them. She told me I was just having nightmares, that big boys didn't sleep with their parents. So when I was so scared, I would sneak in and sleep on the rug. I know today what was happening to me then. But when I was so young, this was all new. It was hard to know what was real. Who were these beings? My heart told me it was real.
I was frightened and so curious at the same time. I grew up in a family of artists, scientists, and intellectuals. And that allowed me a scientific interest and perspective, even at that age. But I was afraid to talk about it. I was afraid of what people would think of me. So I decided right there to keep it to myself.
For how long, I didn't know. But one day, many years later, I would talk about it.
Thanks, Johnny. Hey, welcome back. We have a great show tonight. Very, very special show tonight. We're going to be talking about UFOs and aliens. Now, there's been a lot of buzz in the media lately with a couple of folks that have had extraterrestrial encounters, if you will. And we got a panel of experts and skeptics. And our first guest is a man who claims that he had been abducted as a child. Please welcome Mark Neill. Mark, welcome to the show.
How are you doing?
Have a seat.
My brother.
All right. Too soon for that?
Never too soon.
Okay. Listen, I got to tell you, I've been reading this. Let's get right to it. I've been reading this stuff, and it's really kind of totally unbelievable. Let's start with aliens. I mean, why are aliens here? If they were here, why don't we know about them? Does the government know about them? They've been hiding. What's in it for them?
Well, I didn't say they were aliens. You said they were aliens.
He's absolutely right. I did say that. I made that up, I think. So if they're not aliens, what are we talking
about? Well, I honestly don't know. If I were to say that they were aliens, it would be pure conjecture on my part.
Okay, sir. Well, let's go back to the beginning. Let's go back to where you first had an encounter, that you had a first experience with this.
I was 7 years old.
That's a great story. Is there any more to it?
I was asleep in my room. I woke up one night to this weird sound. I started to hear a voice inside my head, like a woman's voice.
A woman's voice, like Golda Meir.
This voice told me that they weren't going to hurt me. And then I started to see this being.
Well, what did it look like?
Well, I actually brought an illustration.
Oh, you brought an illustration. Johnny, can you pull that up on the monitor so we can all see it? Oh, wow, that's gnarly. Whoa, that's frightening. That's what you saw? That's ugly. I'm sorry, I don't mean to offend you, but.
I didn't think so. I thought she was beautiful.
Really?
Eloquent, even, highly intelligent. She touched me, and then I blacked out. The next thing I knew, it was morning.
Okay, well, I could do a whole half hour on she touched me. Wow, okay, so you've been having those experiences that you just described, you've been having those your whole life. Did you ever consider that maybe there were a dream or some illusion created by a chemical imbalance or a mental illness?
Sure, I've considered all those possibilities, and I've always come up empty-handed. I mean, I've never been diagnosed with any form of mental illness. And if these are dreams, then they're dreams that I've shared with thousands of other people who've had the exact same dream. And people I've never interacted with and who've never interacted with me. So there's something there.
Okay, well, there's something there, but do you have any proof? Do you have anything you can show us?
Well, I have evidence. I mean, I suppose you could call it proof. Most people try to discredit it. I mean, you know about the implants,
right.
Photographs,
yes,
videos, corroborating witnesses who were there at the time that these incidents happened. I have all of those things.
Oh, in fact, you brought with you an x-ray of your arm, but before we show that, can you just tell us a little bit about what we're going to see?
Yeah, I have discovered like a lump under the skin in my arm.
Well, couldn't that just be a cyst?
Well, that's what I thought it was, but I had Dr. Robert Leonard look at it. He's actually done a lot of research and even surgical removal of these kinds of implants. He was interested in my case because he knew about my particular history.
Right, Dr. Leonard, we've actually researched this doctor. He's totally legitimate. Now, did he want to perform surgery on you?
Yes, he did, but first I wanted to know exactly what this thing was. I mean, it was perfectly round and disc shape, which is very unusual for a fibroid cyst. So he suggested that I go to a radiologist, have an x-ray.
Okay, and what was found?
Well, first of all, it was perfectly, almost transparent. It almost didn't even show up on the x-ray. But the radiologist said something very strange to me. He asked me when I'd broken my arm, said I must be in a lot of pain. I didn't know what he was talking about. I've never broken a bone in my life.
So he must have seen something in that x-ray that told him this. Can we put up the picture for our audience to see? What are we looking at?
Well, if you look here, you can see how perfectly that bone is broken. I mean, that could not have happened naturally. The only way that could have been done was deliberately.
And what did you tell the radiologist?
Well, when I told the radiologist that I'd never broken a bone before, he got very angry at me. He actually called me a liar. He said if I wasn't going to tell the truth, then we had nothing else to talk about.
Okay, so let's get this straight. You've just said you've never broken a bone in your body in your whole life, right?
Right.
Correct? And how do you prove that? How can you prove that there's any, like, family history? Anybody in your family?
Yes, my mother, okay. Medical records. Around the same time, I looked at my arm in bright sunlight. I saw a scar going all the way around it, as if it had been severed at some point and then reattached.
Sure, yeah, I do that twice a week. It cleans out the blood. Sir, really, see how far-fetched this sounds? This sounds like something from a science fiction television show.
Well, where do you think they get their ideas?
That's a good point.
Look, I'm not alone in this. There are lots of other people who have evidence of surgeries being performed on them that no doctors they know of have done.
And you and the others that have experienced this, other people that have experienced this around the world throughout history, have no idea who or what is doing this to you.
No. All I know is that I have been interacting with an intelligence that is not human. That I share this experience with thousands, maybe millions of other people who have gone through the exact same thing. Credible people from all walks of life. We have videos, photographs, eyewitnesses, physical evidence, and yet we are disregarded by the scientific community, by the government, and by the public. I've been told by more than one scientist that even if we presented proof to them, that they would refuse to believe it. But something is there.
So you're saying thousands of people, millions of people over time, over around the world, have experienced this same phenomenon. And yet, how could that many people be experiencing the same delusion, right? I mean, it's not like all these people can be crazy.
Now you're starting to get it. No, they can't be.
I don't get it. We'll be back.
This was hard to do, and it hurt my career, but I felt so strongly that I was a normal human being and I needed to share this. There were so many crazy people out there. I was sure I wasn't one of them.
Thank you, everybody, for coming today to the meeting. I want to introduce a brand new member today, Mark. Say hi to the group. Say hi to Mark. Make him feel welcome.
Hi, Mark. Hi, Mark.
And Mark, for your first time and all the first timers, you really don't have to share if you feel uncomfortable. You can ask questions of the group, but if you'd like to share, then we're here for you.
Thank you. It wasn't easy for me to come here today. I've never spoken to anyone other than Yvonne about my experiences. In the back of my mind, in spite of how real all of this has felt to me, I've been hoping that it was all just in my head, not real.
Mark, my name is John. And trust me when I tell you that we've all hoped for that. No matter how hard we try to prove it to ourselves that our experiences are delusional, we've never found it. We are all, for lack of a better word, sane.
I had a secret most of my life. I didn't tell anyone. I had a childhood friend, and one day I was in a bookstore, and I saw their face on a book cover. It was entitled Communion. That book changed my life. I could never have known that I was not alone in this experience if I had not read that book. I'd never met Mr. Strieber or heard anyone else talk of these things. But there it was in his book. And I knew it was just the same experience that I'd had. How could that be possible if there wasn't something out there?
I had the same experience with communion. I suppose all of you did. It's the same story, isn't it? It started out when we were children. We lived our lives with it in secret. Some of us tried to speak out about it. It's never received very well. You can come out of the closet about just about anything right now, and you get a pat on the back for it, but come on about this. They want to stone you to death. I'm here because I need to hear your experiences. I'll share mine with you, but suffice to say, I think that you'll find it to be similar, if not identical.
Well, Mark, I thank you for sharing your story, and I commend you for opening up to all of us. I know that we can learn something from your story, and we can all grow from what we hear from you.
Okay. Does anyone like to share your experience at this time with the group?
I have something to share.
Okay, Rob.
It's something I really didn't need Yvonne to put me under hypnosis for, but the hypnosis did help bring out some detail. Nevertheless, it is something that I've always remembered. I was in my early 20s. I was in love with a girl that I met in college, and she moved to UC Davis, which was about an hour away from where I lived in Pacifica. It's a small town down the coast of San Francisco. I used to drive up to see her often, and on one particular night, something happened. It was about 11 p.m. when I left Davis, and I was not tired at all. It was a very short drive, yet somewhere down that stretch of the 101 near San Francisco and the Bay Bridge, I began to grow tired. And then I heard this voice. It kept telling me that I was tired and that I should pull over and get some sleep. I fought it. I fought hard, but I was losing. So I decided to look for an area to pull over, an exit near a dark frontage road. Pulled off, and all I could find was this dirt path. I was so tired. I thought to myself, just go to sleep for a few hours and you'll be okay. I must have been asleep for a while, but I woke up to bright light shining in my face. And that's when I saw the men. Woke up. I wasn't sure how much time had passed, but it seemed like some had. I was in a different place. It was dark. There was just a little bit of light. and then I found myself being walked down a narrow hallway. I could feel a presence next to me, and it was one of the men. And they took me into this room that had tanks all along the wall. I could just make something out inside of the tank. And I could sense that the man standing next to me wanted me to see what was in the tank. I wasn't afraid. And I wasn't sure what it was, but I felt connected to it. It was a fetus. A baby. But it didn't look like us, exactly. I looked around, and I noticed that there were tanks all over the walls. The walls stretched out in every direction. There were hundreds of them. And then I blacked out again. And when I came to, I was in another room. It was round, and there was a domed ceiling. I was really disoriented. They must have put me under sedation. I don't know. Maybe they wanted me to feel like it was all a dream. I don't know. Then I felt a presence again, and I felt someone standing next to me. I head to the right, I looked down, and I saw her. And as I continued to look at her, the room began to go dark. And then suddenly it seemed like we weren't even in a room anymore. And that's when it happened. She waved her hand, and suddenly we were in the middle of what felt like our universe. I don't know if it was real or a hologram, but it felt real. What she showed me was a wonder. What she showed me was the most amazing thing I'd ever seen. I was so overcome with emotion as I was taking it in. I felt lucky and at the same time very, very, very humbled that this was being shown to me. And then I heard her voice inside my head. She was speaking to me. We are all children of the stars. You must never feel disconnected from your universe. Where are all your cares now? Your earth, your wars, your hatred, your misgivings? Try to find your home within the vastness, the immenseness of all of this. This is your home. Feel it with your soul, for this is what life is. I tried to take all of it in. I kept staring at the stars. I could never have stared long enough. I didn't ever want it to end. I wanted to take it into my heart and keep it. And like those old cowboy astronauts that went into space and came back changed, so would I. Forever. And I was actually glad. After a while, her voice began to fade and the stars began to fade. And I started to black out again.
And what happened? Are you all right?
I'm okay.
When I woke up, I began to feel just a little bit panicked. I got behind the wheel, started up my car, and began to drive again. It felt good to be on the road. And soon I was at the familiar Bay Bridge. And just as I was starting to feel normal, I was crossing the bridge and I noticed this billboard. It was a billboard that I'd seen about a million times every time I made that trip. But this billboard had a clock on it. And what I noticed about the clock is that I had left Davis at 11 p.m., but the time on the clock said it was 3 a.m. Now, if you remember when I first told you about this, I did not feel tired at all. And maybe I stopped to rest a little bit, but I could not possibly have slept that long. I lost at least 2 hours. The longest time I thought that this was all a dream. But then I met all of you and I found out that you all had the same dream. And that's when I knew that something was there.
I soon found out I wasn't alone with these experiences, not by a long shot. I shared exactly the same experience with these people, and I had never met them or talked to them before. I didn't have school today. It was Saturday. I never really liked school. I didn't feel like I fit in there. I felt deeply different. I noticed and wondered about things the other kids didn't. I love playing in our big backyard. It was a wonderland, covered in growth, bugs, lizards, and more. It was a young boy's paradise with so much to explore. It's our gardener, Mr. Lee. He came here every Saturday to mow the lawns and trim the garden.
Hello, Mark.
He was always fun to talk with. It was hard to tell how old he was, but to me he seemed ancient.
Well, I'm going to trim the overgrowth. Dead leaves and branches can harm plants.
He was wise and knowledgeable, always telling me great stories.
It's important to take care of this garden called Mother Earth. Because if you take care of her, she'll allow the garden to take care of you.
If there was a plant or creature I saw in the backyard, he always knew about it.
Yeah, meet my new friend, Mark. This lizard must have been someone's pet that got lost because he's not indigenous to San Francisco.
Wow, Mr. Lee, he's beautiful. I've seen him before, but I could never catch him. He always runs away so fast.
Well, you don't have to catch him. You can just offer to him. You see, Mark, you're deeply connected to every living thing in your world. And everything's connected to you, never separate. And if you connect to the universe, then all will be yours. Even this little creature. Sense your intentions because you're both connected to the same reality. Now, if you only have curiosity and love in your heart, he won't fear you.
Is that why he hopped onto your hand?
That's right. You cannot separate from that which you're a part of. You're special, Mark. You're different. You're aware of so many things inside you and around you that other children are not. But you have to be careful not to speak to others about what we talk about. There will be those that you can talk to, and you'll know who they are one day. You'll just know in your heart.
Years later, when I was an adult, my mother told me we never had a gardener. I always wondered about the men in the car. I'd see them sitting there often. I wondered if it had anything to do with me.
I'm getting a little peckish. What do you say we go for a pizza?
Thank you for that. Not that place we went to last time, though.
Yeah, that gave you gas.
Lots of it.
Yeah, and I have to smell it.
Yeah, you pick the place.
My mother told me that they were G-men, that they kept an eye on us because of my step-grandfather. He was a scientist who worked on particle accelerators at Berkeley University. He invented the camera that was the first to photograph the splitting of the atom.
Kid's watching us again. Think he knows?
Hell if I know. He always watches the watchers.
Mother notices us too. So you notice that, huh?
Yeah, the grandfather comes here all the time. His high-level security clearance is the reason why we're here.
My grandfather and my dad's side of the family was different. He told me some amazing stories also. He grew up in Ireland and lived with my grandmother in the countryside of Marin County. I spent many wonderful summers with them. I loved to be there in the country. The night skies were amazing. You could see the Milky Way and a million stars from there.
Grandfather, what's that moving star?
I don't know, Mark. But if I had to guess, it might be Sputnik.
Will people go to space, Grandfather?
One day, I'm sure they will.
They'll go to the moon. I just know they will. I wish I could go.
You just might one day. The future looks bright, and we're headed fast towards the stars.
What's that red star? Is it a meteor?
I don't know what it is. But it looks like one.
What's happening, Grandfather?
I don't know, Mark.
Is it gonna hurt us?
No, it's not.
Grandfather, what did we see?
I don't know, Mark. It wasn't a meteor. They don't behave like that. I've seen some things, but I just don't know. But it seemed to notice us.
Grandmother! We just saw something outside. It was a huge red ball, and it just hovered over us.
Your grandfather sees all kinds of things, Mark, but I wouldn't take it serious.
No, we saw it.
Oh, you just saw a meteor, Mark, that's all. He's had you seeing something it's not. Next, he'll have you seeing leprechauns. You've seen those before, too, right, Father? How about the banshees or the ghosts? He believes in all that nonsense, Mark.
Oh, knock it off. You always make fun of me. I saw those things. And I saw the red light in the sky, and so did Mark. And I do not believe in the things that I have experienced. I know it.
And there is a big difference between believing in something and knowing it.
Well, I guess you told me, you old fool. But don't go making the boy into a fool, too, just because you believe in fantasies. You're a grown man at your age, for God's sake.
For God's sake? You don't believe in God either.
No, I don't. And don't be telling the boy about God either. Let him grow up first and decide.
They always fought about these things. My grandmother was mean to him. I hated that about her. She was a good person, but she didn't believe in things that went bump in the night. My grandfather told me so many stories of experiences he had in Ireland, but he wasn't just telling stories or tall tales. He really did have these experiences. You could see the look of fear in his eyes when he told them to me.
Mark, there are people who experience things that they just don't want to talk about. It's true that I saw those things. And the story I'm about to tell you is real. It happened. Now, as for God, well, your grandmother's right about that one. You'll have to decide for yourself. I could tell you, but something is there. When I was a young man in Ireland, I was taking my mother home at night, as I often did, from town. We were in one of those horse-drawn carriages. And as the horse was pulling the carriage down the road, we approached the old churchyard. Now, I'd passed this churchyard many times before, but tonight something was different. As we got closer to the churchyard, the horse began to protest. It began to cry and resist my commands. And as we got closer to the church itself, the horse began to buck. Something in that churchyard was frightening it. We stopped. I got out of the carriage to investigate what the commotion was all about. I could just see through the trees into the churchyard. The church was very old. It was made of stone, and it was L-shaped. And the two walls would meet in a corner. And sitting on the ledge was a man. I could barely make him out through the trees, so I entered the churchyard and slowly began to approach him. As I got closer, I could see his trench coat and his brimmed hat. Upon later reflection, the strangeness of all this occurred to me because people at the turn of the century did not wear trench coats and brimmed 1940s-styled hats. Are you all right? Can I help you? He looked up at me. Those eyes. He looked like the devil himself. I ran to the carriage as fast as I could and got home as quickly as possible. I will never know what I saw that night. The devil, a ghost, a demon. But it scared me to death, and I will never, never forget it.
This story really grabbed me, remembering it years later as an adult. By this point, I knew about the cloven feet, as described by my grandfather. I'd seen them myself one late night in my kitchen. I knew my grandfather was telling the truth. He wasn't crazy. Either way, he knew his own experience as I did mine. Years later, my close friend Whitley Strieber would tell me about the cloven feet. But my grandfather thought they were devils. It was the only sense he could make out of it in those times. But today, I don't think so.
And then it happened. I saw the face my grandfather saw all those years ago looking right at me. Who were they? What did they want? As I would lie in bed listening to my mother playing the piano, as she did nearly every night, I know now why I felt different. Every night when I went to bed, I never knew what to expect. It was October 2017, and I was outside on the phone talking to my old friend Whitley when something amazing happened, something that came without warning. At first, I thought I was seeing an owl illuminated by the city lights, but as I watched it, it became apparent it wasn't an owl. As it flew over me, I was overwhelmed with emotion, and I described it to Whitley. As it disappeared into the night, I felt something inside. I didn't hear it. It was almost as if I could see it. A message came to me. Something that's there continues my amazing journey into the stars. There's still hope. Don't give up.
The message Mark received from the visitors is true. There is still much hope. The people that know this won't ever give up. We can't. As we look into our children's eyes, we can see that hope. It's up to us to secure their future. Is this one of the reasons the visitors are in our lives? Maybe. We have separated from true reality, the very reality that connects us with the earth and the stars from which we were born. We are truly lost among the stars, and someone or something is trying to show us the way. In our next episode, Mark discovers that nothing ever truly dies. He finds that we are part of a reality that knows no death, and that our dreams are more than just dreams. They are gateways to other worlds. Join us next time in The Dream Time. Thank you.
excellent film. Thank you, Steve, for sharing that. We really appreciate it. So I'd like to call Steve up to the podium and then have some Q&A about the film and then about the subject of abduction or alien contact. So Steve, come on up. And then the mic is over there, guys. So you guys will be over there. Steve will be over here. And who'd like to go first? First of all, Steve, how about if you talk about the two guys who were standing outside and their faces were revealed? What is that, or what are we taking away from? Who are these guys?
We need you back at the mic, Steve. Sorry.
Yeah. We need you back in this mic.
Yeah.
That was my question. Well, you know, through my experience, I've not always seen what people refer to as the grays. I've seen a lot of different things. A lot of very odd humanoid type or hominid people. And some of them, other than being tall and kind of thin, and they have very elongated faces, could really quite easily pass in public. I mean, you would never really, probably not pay attention to them. So I had a lot of dealings with that, and also ones that looked similar to what my grandfather described. And, you know, if you've seen or studied the Men in Black, research has been done out there, you've probably even seen some of the videos which allegedly are actual. I've seen some of them, and they very well might be. And astonishingly enough to me, when I saw them, they were like what I was used to seeing. So it doesn't mean that that's so, but it was very striking to me. So, and I would see them outside, and in my mind, I would be trying to figure out what they were talking about. So really, when they were talking, and like very adolescent people themselves, because that was really the fantasies that were in my mind, what are they talking about? You know, what are they, why are they there? The interesting thing about my mother is that she told me about them and told me about how she would invite them in and give them coffee and stuff. And she always assumed it was because of my grandfather. But then later on, when she got older, she had no memory of it, which is odd. Yet she had recent memories, like right up to the point where she passed away, of being on the porch in a house in the country and describing this black circle moving among the stars, and the way that she could see it is because she couldn't see the stars where the circle was. And then it would get closer and closer, and then she said lights would come out of that circle and shine at her. And so when I asked her what happened, she said, well, you know, I went in the house, and the lights kind of followed me in. And I said, well, what happened after that? And there'd be this long pause, and she'd say, I don't remember. Just had no name at all. My mother and I did not even talk for 18 years. We were always estranged. I don't know if this has something to do with it or not, but that's a whole other story. So, but I did see those strange guys, and so I referred to them as G-Men. So, Yvonne, have you run into that at all, with people seeing things besides the grays?
Oh, absolutely. There are all types of alien beings that people come across. On the craft, they have identified the little grays, mm-hmm. who usually take the person out from their normal environment. On the craft, they will see the taller ones that look like the small ones. Mm-hmm. There is, and I tell people, there is a definite chain of command when you're on the ship. There's the praying mantis type. Many times he's just standing in the corner watching or directing people. The beings, whatever they're doing, examinations, experiments. There's the light beings that are just illuminated within themselves.
Yeah, I've heard about that.
There's the, we used to call them back in the day, the Nordics.
Oh, yes.
But now, you know, I'm calling them the perfected hybrids. Because like, we film now, and I've had several experiencers tell me that they feel that they've interacted with a hybrid down here on Earth. So, you know, something's happening with these hybrid babies. I mean, they're growing up. And I feel now that they are among us. My colleague, Dr. David Jacobs' latest book, and I just drew a blank on the name of it, but it'll get to me. It's senior moment. I'm sorry, guys. I've been doing this 26 years. Like, I'm starting to lose my train of thought. I think it's Aliens Among Us.
Is that what it is?
Something like that.
I really haven't kept up on the whole hybrid thing.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I did see the baby tanks, and
I used
a child and told it was mine, but I used
that one piece of artwork that you did for me many years ago with the baby tanks along the wall there, and that resonates with so many people. It's unbelievable. I've used, as Steve mentioned earlier in his talk, he's done some beautiful artwork for me and some very latest pieces, which I'm very excited to incorporate.
Yeah, but there'll be more too. What's been a fascinating journey for me with the artwork is I started drawing the beings as far back as the 70s and into the 80s, but it was really the early 90s is when I really did that definitive gray look that everybody knows today. That started here with this guy.
Wow.
I never thought about copywriting it or trademarking it or anything like that. It just didn't occur to me because I was just doing drawings of what I saw. The reaction from other people who had the experience, people I didn't know, was overwhelming. The email, the people coming up to me, I would appear with Yvonne at some of the conferences and stuff, and including Whitley Strieber, and it was overwhelming how many people would say, that's, you know, I've seen other drawings, but that's really it, so many times. In hindsight, I probably should have copied my I finally got a letter from Alienware when they came out with their computers suggesting that maybe I would cease and desist using their copyrighted image, and I said, you don't want to go there, because, you know, I got the goods on this. I've got the artwork and the documentation going way back. I never heard from them again, and suddenly the chin went from being very pointed to round as it is today, so. But so that was an amazing thing, is doing the artwork and not knowing whether you were seeing something unique or something that other people saw exactly or not, and then having all these people flood forward and tell you, that's what I saw, even getting a phone call one night from Willie Strieber, and we've been friends ever since, so.
A couple questions, so. The very first scene, you kind of left us hanging there. Mm-hmm. Was that an actual experience?
Yeah, that was my first experience. That my first memory, and Yvonne knows about this because you have the artwork, there's this piece of art I did called Crib Visit. And I have this memory, the earliest memory that I have of being alive, being conscious, was looking at the bars of a crib and seeing one of those faces staring at me. And I did a piece of art of it that became quite popular with people, because it turns out many other people had that memory as well. But the first time that I had an unclouded, fully awake, crystal clear, unconscious memory was waking up, because where I lived in San Francisco, it was near Playland and the beach, and it was a city, and even at night, there was a lot of ambient noise. I woke up to a vacuum. The only thing I could hear was my own breathing and my heart pounding. And I looked over and there were these lights silently sweeping my bedroom, just like you saw. And I did just get out of bed and was very curious, creeped along, looked up over the sill to see where it was coming from. And that's when I realized there was something behind the light, because it suddenly, oh, there he is. You know, that's when I really started to get scared.
Could the gentleman outside be Men in Black? You consider that?
That's what they're called, you know. I mean, I've had lots of experiences, and Yvonne knows about this. I was very prolific with my experiences on television and in media, appearing many times with Yvonne and with Whitley on all kinds of national shows. And what was more disturbing than the experience was how my own people reacted to my sharing this publicly with people. I got a call one day from the studios where I was working, and the girl there asked me if I was in trouble with the law. And I said, no, absolutely not. I mean, it just was preposterous. I mean, it really took me off guard that I would be asked that by the studios. She says, well, evidently you are, because two gentlemen came in here in a very official capacity and with ID badges and stuff and said, and I quote, and I always remember this, it is not in your best interest to continue working with him. Yeah, and this wasn't the first time it happened.
Yeah, just one more question. Where do we see the rest of your series?
Well, it hasn't been made yet, and that's why we're releasing this to the public. And rather than trying to stream it, charge money to see it, I want to share this with the public, let everybody see it, because the reactions to it are very mixed. People who have no interest in the subject or maybe have a light interest in it but don't know what we know from our involvement in it don't care for it much. But people who are involved, and you know what I mean by involved, they really like it. They want to see more. And so it's my hope by sharing with the public is that I'll reach the people who really care about this subject the most. Because this was really kind of made for them. There's a lot of people hiding in the shadows, afraid to come forward because of the ridicule. And because of the movies that have been made, which really kind of make fun of it, don't really give it the credibility and the respect the subject matter deserves. This needs to be studied. This needs to be worked out.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Guys, Yvonne Smith is here available for questions, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
You may not have a question for Steve, but maybe for Yvonne, so feel free. Okay.
And I want to thank Yvonne for being in the film, too. Really added a lot to it.
Yeah, hi, I have a question for Yvonne. I've wondered years and years, you hear a lot about the messages that experiencers get from the grays, like dire things are going to happen, you're special, and don't worry, everything's good, it's going to come out fine. It seems like it's sort of all over the map. What is their agenda for communicating these things, and is there any credibility to them?
Just take the mic off there.
Yeah.
Thank you. That's a great question. Over the years, I have heard, I've been doing this 26 years, working intimately with people in private session, and over the years I've heard that they've been told, and people remember consciously and in the course of regression, that we are not taking care of our planet, that we need to pay more attention, that we can turn things around. All we need to do, and this sounds so simplistic, to love each other. And we can turn things around for the better. Now, for the last 4 or 5 years, I've heard, seems to be accelerated. Because I've heard from new people coming to see me, people that don't know each other, one after another coming into my office and they're saying the same thing. And what I've been getting from people is, I know I'm supposed to be doing something. They feel an anxiety. They don't know what they're supposed to be doing. They also told me, and I have people that have had successful businesses. They make six figures. They're living in Beverly Hills, you know, Bel Air. And they've told me, and I've had, you know, more than two people in that tax bracket tell me, you know, the money doesn't mean anything to me anymore. I've worked really hard, I have all these degrees, you know, I have all the material things that they said, but something, I'm supposed to be doing something else with my life. And I've heard, and as I kept hearing this, and people told me, my members in Ciro, some of them are here, have been with me for the last 25, 26 years, like Steve. We've had discussions in our meetings, but they're telling me that They're feeling that things, whatever it is, something's going to happen, and it's accelerating. How many here have felt this? Wow, quite a few of you. And I've been asking the audiences now, every time I lecture, I've been to the Congress, I just came back from Switzerland, every time I lecture, in Roswell, where I started a local support group there, I ask that question, and it's amazing to me how many people raise their hands and telling me that they feel an anxiety that they are supposed to do something. My latest book, Chosen, it's a revision of my original book with the black cover. I don't know if any of you remember that, but I revised it. Well, it was a long story with my publisher and being dishonest and all of that. I had to change it. And I hope none of you have that experience. You know, if you write your own books, you have to be very careful. But I decided I had so much material with this, and I call it the urgency, that the second part of the book is about this. And some cases of people, quotes that I, you know, some of our serial members. And it's amazing because so many people don't know each other and they're telling the same thing. I only got 3 copies because I ran out. I sold out in Roswell. But I also wanted to tell you, before we get to this gentleman with this question, I brought my book, Coronado. And I don't know if any of you are familiar with this, the book and the case. The case had not been publicized at all, but it took me many years to write this because it's about a mass abduction that occurred on Coronado Island in San Diego. About a dozen people that were from our serial support group. This was in March of 1994, and I was working with people still in regression. I had to go out of town to do more regressions as I was writing it. Steve is in it.
Yeah.
And this is before he came out and talked about his own experiences. He is Sam in his chapter.
This is because my late wife wanted me not to have anything to do with this.
So if you, it's on, I have copies here, but if you buy it from Amazon and you come across the chapter with Sam and Gary. Sam is Steve Neill, and they had an incredible experience there too. So I wanted to share that with you because now that Steve is coming out and talking about this publicly, I think it's important to know what he's been through, and that's why this project is very important. And please spread the word because Steve needs the financial backing so we can continue it.
Oh, thanks. That's why I'm releasing it to the public. I'm hoping someone out there comes forward. And so I want to see more of this, and here's my checkbook.
Yeah, I was just wondering, Yvonne, if you could say a little bit more about what your assumption is about the agenda of the alien, the Greys that do the bulk of the abductions. Because, for instance, David Jacobs says that they don't care about the humans doing well on the planet. And it just seems like there's multiple agendas that are kind of confusing.
Well, there's multiple theories because we really don't know. If anybody tells you, this is what it is, this is what they're doing, run the other way, because we really don't know. What I have gathered in my 26 years, and I know David Jacobs very well, and I've read his book, we've had discussions about his theories and how they're walking among us, and he, it's more like, I compare it to Invasion of the Body Snatchers. I don't want to look at it that way. I don't think, they're not evil. They're definitely not evil. And if they wanted to destroy us, they could have done it a long time ago. But they need us. They need our DNA, they need our material. They also need our emotions. That's why they're creating these hybrid children, babies, and the children grow up and they abduct a person again. Like, it was our gentleman in the support group. He was shown you know, the wall of tanks with the babies.
Yeah, that's very
common. Oh my gosh, it's so common. It's so very common. Men and women are shown these babies. They are told these babies or this baby is theirs, and they must love it.
They show them
when they're growing.
Absolutely.
Children, you know, adolescents, teenagers, they show your children in different stages of growth. And John in Coronado, he's amazing because he was in my original book, Chosen. You know John?
Oh, yeah.
He was very, very traumatized. We had to do 3 sessions to get through looking at the baby as his baby. And then he was also part of the Coronado mass abduction. John, I won't use his last name, but when I interviewed him for Coronado, and then we did a couple, 2 or 3 more sessions for that case, I call it, there's a graduation process in this experience. They now, during the course of the abduction in Coronado, they had him and they had Melinda, and I'll use her name, Melinda Leslie. Some of you may know her very well. She's been in the field a long time. They had Melinda and John, traumatized John, helping the experiencers come in, calming them down, helping them on the tables. I was so amazed. This came out in John's regression, and I said, oh my God. After I brought him out, I said, John, do you realize that you graduated? He wasn't traumatized. He was actually, he goes, I didn't want to escort people down to the lower level because he knew what was going to happen to him. He goes, but I knew I was supposed to do it. I couldn't stop doing it. But it wasn't where he's in that traumatized mode. So there's a graduation process with all of this. And so I feel like that, you know, they're not evil. I feel they do care about us earth things, human beings, in their capacity, and that they can care about us. But they really don't show or cannot show emotion. That's why they need us in the process, the growing process of these hybrid children. They need our emotions and how we connect with each other and how we bond, because that's what's going to help these children grow, these people grow. So I don't feel that they're going to clone us and take us over and get rid of the real Yvonne or the real Steve. Of course, this is my theory. I don't know. They're not telling me anything specifically, although I ask them all the time. But this is my thought, that they're giving us messages. They're giving people messages. You know, why would they do that if they were going to just take us over and get rid of us?
Well, just like at the end of this, that actually happened. I was on the phone with Whitley, and the film was almost finished, and we already had an ending on it. When I saw that, I thought it was a bird, an owl at night. It just looked that way. It was kind of fuzzy, and it was moving towards me. And the next thing I knew, you could hear a pin drop. It was so quiet. And there was this triangle, and it was ghostly like at first, but it became much more resolved in focus. And as it flew over, I got very emotional, because, you know, here I am, Mary's inside the house. The time it would take me to yell for anybody to come and see it or think about getting a camera would have been gone. So I selfishly just took the experience in and described it to Whitley over the phone as it was happening. It was amazing, and so I put it at the end of the film.
And he
emailed me. And I did get the message.
And he told me the message, and I sent the email announcement to all of our members.
Right.
Because everyone does get messages. So I feel that they are bringing experiencers together. They've been bringing them into my support group. That's why I called my book Chosen. You know, why they choose us, I don't know. But they're bringing us together for a reason. I think when it comes down to it, and if we're getting these little bits and pieces of disclosure coming out, you know, really, I sit there and I go, we told you guys this.
Yeah.
This has been happening. But for the general public, I guess whoever the powers that be is doling this information out. And I think we're going to be needed, probably, for when disclosure does happen.
First of all, when was the last time that both of you actually happened to have contact with any of these individuals?
Well, for me personally, it's been about a month, I think, about a month ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have to think about that. When I have a very vivid dream or something, I write it down, and I keep a journal in my computer. I tell everybody I work with to keep a journal. But I want to share this that I've never shared before, and I shared it with my Roswell audience, but I have been quiet about my experiences for a very long time, because I was cautioned by Bud Hopkins, who was my mentor, when I started, that he says, you know, don't tell the public that you've had experiences, because you might lose objectivity and credibility. And so I kept quiet for a very long time. But when I started hearing about the urgency from people, and people from all walks of life, people from our group, we have a lawyer member, Jim, who has come out publicly. He's going to be retiring from his law practice, but I feel, and there's been other people coming forward, and I feel, you know, if they come forward publicly, and like Steve did, then I need to as well. And I feel that my own experiences has only helped me be a better therapist, because I understand when somebody tells me, I just feel him there. I just feel her there. Oh, I just know what they're saying. I know exactly what they're talking about, or when they have a flashback. But I have an implant in my knee, and it's, when you said it was perfectly round, yours, mine's perfectly round, it moves around. I spoke with my dear friend and colleague that we all miss, Dr. Roger Lear.
Yes, we do.
He had his colleague take x-rays of it, and what happened was mine didn't show up, probably because it is, or, you know, transparent.
I didn't either.
But mine,
arm did.
Exactly. Mine moves around. The doctor told me it's not a cyst, it's not anything like that, it's not attached to anything. And I thought it disappeared one time. It went like under my kneecap, and now it's back. And I had a psychic friend. She wanted to come near me and kind of do a reading. And she got near it. We were at a conference. Things happen at conferences, you guys. So you But I was sitting in my bed in the hotel. I had my legs out, and she started approaching it. It moved, and I thought about Whitley. So I do not want to have it removed.
No.
I don't think I should. People ask me, should they have them, theirs removed? I say, no, I don't recommend it unless it's causing you pain, discomfort, you're feeling ill. But mine is there, and I feel it's there for a reason. So
I feel the same way. Do you do know that I have one in my ear exactly like Whitley's?
Yes.
In the same side, and it also moves. If people try to touch it, it will move.
It'll move, yep. How many here get tones in their ears? In one ear.
Yes.
Just one ear.
Like tinnitus type noises?
But it's
There's
not
a difference real. Between the time tinnitus and this particular type of tone.
It's like somebody dials up and it turns up louder.
Yeah.
How many have had that? Anybody having it tonight?
In other words, you're saying that tinnitus isn't necessarily something that's very mundane. It can be something.
Yeah, it's probably not even tinnitus.
Yeah.
It's, we're being tuned in.
Yeah.
You know, the very term abduction implies taking against will without consent, right? That's abduction, not, you know, there is another experience, we call it contact, we call them experiencers, but in the abduction scenario, almost never is it something where the victim, we'll call it, or the subject, has given consent. You know, I got into this field in 2001 when I had a very, very strong sight. And that immersed me in what we're doing right now. Up to that point, I was very pragmatic. I was an engineer, I was a pilot, blah, blah, blah. I was an educated man. I didn't believe in this stuff, I didn't even think about it. It wasn't part of my nomenclature, it wasn't part of my thought process. But after I got into this and began examining my life, I had memories that I had suppressed. And it turned out, for example, I was in junior high, I was scribbling on the back of one of these blue notebooks we used to have, the cloth ones, and I was scribbling, listening to the teacher, the homeroom guy, and as I looked down, boom, there was a face with a hood. It was an alien face. Similar, it didn't have a pointy chin, very wrinkled skin. I drew it very well. I was not a good artist, but I drew a very good picture of it. And the recognition was there, and the words came to my mind, there you are. So I have that in my past. I have memories when I was a kid in junior high where I knew if I could make it past 3 a.m. and not fall asleep, I might not be taken through the walls. And this is a thought, this is going on in the, what, early 70s? Nobody really talked about abduction. Nobody talked about this stuff. I used to have dreams about little guys coming to get me and taking me through the walls. So I'm an abductee, right? Or at least that's what you would conclude, all right? I can't say that 100%. Maybe I was just dreaming the whole thing up. My point is that abduction doesn't necessarily have positive connotation to it. So I'd like you guys to comment on that. For example, her implant or your implant, what is its purpose? It was put there without your consent. It's essentially a spying device. It may control your thoughts, and yet you don't object to it because you feel like maybe you're being directed. You're hoping. You're hoping that you're being directed to a higher purpose. And I think that that's a commonality, that's a common thing that I've noticed in abductees, is that they have to believe that there's something that they've been chosen for that's better in order to deal with the trauma that they're going through. And I want you guys to comment on that, if you wouldn't mind.
Gosh, this whole phenomenon is so complex. And like I said, I don't have definitive answers. But I feel, yes, abduction, you know, means that you've been taken against your will. And believe me, people don't, everybody is on a different level with this. That's why I established a support group. Everybody respects each other. If someone is angry, we have a couple of new people that are very angry about this. They don't want this to be happening. Nobody ever tells them, look, you're wrong, you've been thinking about this, don't be angry. I mean, everybody has a right to their own emotions and
everybody's
feelings
different.
About it.
Everybody has different backgrounds, different
right.
psychology, so.
It's, you know, I didn't like it when both my boys were, when they were little, they were having experiences. My son in the back room, and I know he won't mind me pointing him out because he came out and talked about his own experiences in Roswell. Brent, will you stand up? He's helping me at my book table. He was about 4 years old when he started telling me that, you know, he saw a giant, what do you call it, giant, but a spider that was in the corner of his room talking to him. He would come in our room and I saw the scene in the movie where you were sleeping on your parents' bedroom. He did that every single night. And of course my husband, his dad, wasn't very happy about this. He wasn't very happy about when I got into the field because he felt like I was bringing this on to the kids. Needless to say, we're not married anymore.
Sounds very familiar.
But, gosh, Steve, the question is just very complex.
It is.
People will start out, not everybody, but I think the majority of people are traumatized because they don't know what happened to them. You know, it seems that ghosts are so acceptable in our society. How many ghost shows are on television right now? But boy, you put aliens and abduction out there and we get, you know, just slammed for it.
Yeah, and yet the two subject matters are actually connected.
Yes, it is connected, yeah, everything's connected. So, all I can say is, you know, if you had this experience, and now see, with the internet, when I started my practice, we didn't have the internet. We were barely emailing, no texting at all. A lot of it was phone calls, and our phone bills were extraordinary. I used to run to the post office and mail 30 meeting announcements before each serial meeting.
I even found some old ones in my files.
You got to frame them. Now I press one button and it goes to everybody. But, you know, if you've had this experience, you just, you're lucky now because there's a lot of information out there. I'm trying to get therapists trained in other parts of our country. But, you know, there's help out there. And if you're angry and dealing with it, then you're angry. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. But you go through the process and you have support. You sit with other people, like-minded people, and you know that you're not alone. But I never tell somebody, you know, this is a positive experience. So, you know, look at it as being positive. I can't tell somebody that. Steve, what is your...
Well, to me, it's neither positive or negative, the experience. It just isn't. It's something that's quite natural, really, because it's there and it's part of nature and it's part of our universe. And if this is what we have to go through to survive, I mean, I go back, one of my favorite films is 2001 A Space Odyssey, because to me, it's the most important film ever made that speaks about what we're talking about. I mean, for God's sakes, it starts with our early ancestors who are dying, confronting the monolith, which is representative of a presence, a super evolved intelligence that coaxes their evolution enough that they can survive. And then it buries another monolith on the moon, hoping that we will evolve to such a point that we become smart enough to reach the moon and uncover it. And when we did, it sent a signal to them that it was time for us to be looked at one more time. And in doing so, of course, the film ends with this star child with a very large head and bigger eyes. And, you know, when I saw that film, I was in high school and it just mesmerized me. It changed my whole life. I couldn't stop seeing it or thinking about it. But it was more than just because it was a movie, it's because I had a connection with it that I couldn't quite put my finger on. Of course, I do now. So when I look at the experience, I kind of look at it in that way. Am I really being abducted or am I being cradled? Am I being pushed in my evolution of my consciousness to become something more? To expand my consciousness. So, in a lot of ways, I'm very grateful for this experience because I wonder, what would I be like if I didn't have it? You know, would I have the interest that I have? Would I become so interested in astronomy and space sciences, and aerospace, and all the things that I love? And then, as far as the implant's concerned, I agree. I don't think it should be removed, and every time, you know, Roger would say, come on, we ought to remove this thing. You know, it's, no, we'll just leave it. In fact, the night that I had it x-rayed, and you could see it sticking up right there, and we found the break in my arm, and I have never had my arm broken. And the x-ray technician was quite upset with me because he really did think I was lying. Because from his perspective, your arm's broken, man. You should remember something like that. But it never happened. So I get in my car, and I look up in the parking lot, the street light over my head, and it goes out. I back out, I start driving every single street light all the way down, all the way onto the banks of them, down the 118, we're going out. And at this point, I'm just like, I'm tingling with excitement and also kind of a little bit afraid too. And all the way home, they kept going out. Now, I've had experiences with streetlights going out before. Here and there, I could walk under one and go out and step back out, put the mic on. It used to drive my late wife crazy. But that light was amazing. And something, I think, was trying to say to me, leave it alone, you know, so.
So, just got me a news ago, as I said. I've talked to several industry colleagues about it, and I've even had a sighting with a TV crew of mine coming back from Arizona. I was telling them about aliens, and then we're on the interstate. It was super dark, just a stretch coming back from Arizona to LA. We pull over at this rest area, and after I talk about aliens forever, then all of a sudden we get out, and there's actually a bowl in the clouds. Like, it's like a very thin layer of clouds, not smog, but it's like actual clouds, and there's you could see it was dipping in the bowl, but it was see-through, so it's cloaked, I'm assuming. Sorry to back up there. So anyway, it was cloaked, I'm assuming. Anyways, so I've seen it with a film crew, but before we went out and got our camera, and a guy comes up, grabs his cell phone, because we got our gears in the car, and he takes a picture of it, and just got a little itty-bitty circle, and it doesn't come out very well. So anyway, I don't know how I got stuck on that, but I've had several instances of, I was abducted as a child, and I had a lot of experiences as a child. I could see, I could have instances where I'd see the future and stuff like that. Now, my sister got ran over by a car, and I saw it the week before it happened, and then I was 6 years old at the time, and then it happened. Anyways, I had a lot of experiences as a child, and as I'm getting older, I used to dream all the time, and I would dream the same dream over and over and have meaning stuff. Anyways, point being is, after I get older, and I've heard, we had some guy come up here and talk before about, because I'm all about conscious expansion and all that, and it's been a very big fan. So, just say I've expanded my consciousness a few ways. But after the guy that came up here, and I can't remember what his name was, but he said that anybody that's ever done drugs or anything like that, no aliens will ever contact them again or anything like that. Is that true or anything? Is it like... That's where my story
is. I mean, I was in high school in 1968, 69, 70. What do you think? That's why I was coming after you. But, I was friends with Timothy Leary.
That's why.
And it was all done in the name of searching our own being. It really was. It wasn't about getting high. It was about having vision quests and discovering who you are.
I completely agree, and that's why I wanted to come ask you.
But it's like, what came first, the chicken or the egg? Did I take LSD because I had these experiences, or did I have these experiences because I took LSD? I think it's the other way around, but
I
don't anymore. I haven't done anything like that in years and years. But
me either. My second question was, so I used to dream and stuff all the time, and it was very, I had premonitions and stuff like that, and it was like I would feel that I was connected, but now I do not dream at all, and I don't have any experiences, I don't think, anymore. I don't get abducted, I'm not sure, but who knows, so I'm just wondering since I stopped dreaming, I don't have connections with the aliens anymore, or what's going on. I still have sight, and I see strips, and I with the film crew and stuff like that, but I just want to know if maybe since the dreaming has something to do with, since I don't dream anymore, I'm not connected to the aliens, or what would be the...
I know, the dream time seems to be, and that's why the next episode is called The Dream Time, goes into this, because I've had so much experience with, I have extremely vivid dreams just like this one right now, where I can touch, feel, and see all of you, and smell, and it's just, you're not dreaming. It's another state of being.
Right. And if you're seeing, you say you've been seeing ships, you have experiences of, then you're being contacted. Because not everybody is lucky enough to see them, but you've had sightings, so you're still in the program.
Yvonne, I'm going to ask you a question. In your research, how many times have you heard about the black hole in the sky? I mean, people automatically, because it's circular, refer to it as a craft. But what if it's not a craft at all, and actually a black hole. In other words, an opening in the fabric of our time-space. And then the whites come through. And I've heard this described by so many people, my mother, myself. It may not be a craft at all. Sometimes it is, clearly. But
right, and you, you're
just
talking about
the absence of light.
They're seeing this with
a shimmer on the edge of it. And,
okay.
And that's what I remember at the Coronado.
Oh, at the Coronado.
Pretty much.
How many here have seen what Steve's describing? No. I haven't, well, you know, I have not had somebody describe it that way, like a hole in the sky, because I think if they're seeing a black object,
mm-hmm.
they feel it's an object,
the
they feel it's a craft.
Well, they can automatically, you know, the way that our culture perceives these types of events is to automatically assume it's a craft. And when I first questioned this is when someone I had met who had actually worked in an official capacity with our government said, I can't tell you much. I believe your story. Were you ever considered that that's not a craft at all?
First of all, beautiful movie. Loved the way it looked.
Oh, thank you.
It was really great. My question is, and to either one of you, maybe both of you could answer, do you find that there's a pattern when the abductions or the visitations are happening in people's lives, whether like on the calendar or personally, is something happening in your life? Or is it a certain time of year when they are happening more often? I'm just curious if there's any patterns that have been detected in the visitations.
I can't say for sure, but you know, I do know right before when Jillian was passing from her cancer that there was activity going on, definitely. There was some sort of vested interest in that whole situation. I do recall that. In other traumatic periods of my life, I seem to recall that there was more activity, but overall, it seems to be fairly random.
Yeah, I haven't had people really talk about a pattern, but there'll be times where someone will have experiences, I mean,
again and again,
constantly.
Night after night. Yes.
And then the experience will go dormant for a while. It can go dormant for a year, two,
yeah.
5 years, and then the, you know, the person feels, oh, okay, I'm done. But then something else happens. So I just tell people, because people in their 70s, 75, tell, and what do they want with me now? You know, I can't give them anything. I just, my feeling is, working with so many people, that once you are in their program, they will have something for you to do.
Yeah, and
it's lifelong.
It starts in that crib.
It's lifelong.
I can't be altogether sure or not if I'm getting a lot of information I'm getting about my experience and about the universe in general, and precognition is not a result of this, of the implant. And I do have more than one.
And in my position, working with so many people intimately, I feel, obviously, put it there for a reason, and I want them to give me some answers.
Yeah.
So I can help more people. So I just don't feel I want to remove it.
All right, well, listen. Guys, we really appreciate it. You guys, thanks for coming. The film was great, and you're welcome back anytime.
Oh, well,
we'd love to have you.